Hey guys, in this video we are going to start building a learning log website using Django. Specifically, we are going to cover chapter 18 of the book Python Crash Course. We'll start by learning about Django, setting up a new app using Django, and then setting up the models and pages. If you want to follow along, you'll find a link to the book in the description down below. Let's get right into it. When we begin a Django project, we are first going to specify what we want to implement and we are going to write a spec. And then after that, we are going to set up a virtual environment in which we can then build our project. So for the project we are building, we wrote a very simple spec here. So we're going to implement a web app called Learning Log, and that's going to allow users to log the topics they're interested in and to make journal entries. The Learning Log app is going to have a homepage, and here we are going to describe the site and also invite users to either register or to sign in if they already have a user account. And then once users are signed in, they will be able to create new topics, add new entries, and also read or edit existing entries. So the spec is going to guide us in that development process, and once we have written that out, we can head over to our terminal. And we first of all are going to create a new project directory from which we are then going to create a virtual environment and start developing our Django app. So let's first create our directory. So here we are just going to say we're going to create a new directory called Learning Log, and let's switch inside of that, and then we can start by creating our virtual environment. And to create our virtual environment, we are running our venv virtual environment module by entering Python -m venv, and then we are specifying the name of the environment. So in this case, we are calling it ll_env for learning log environment, and then we're going to confirm that to actually create that environment. Now, once we've done that, we still need to activate our virtual environment. To do that, we can enter the following command. So here we are entering source, then the name of our environment /bin/activate. And that's going to run the script to activate that environment. And once that environment has been activated, the name of the environment will be shown in parentheses here in front. So this is how we know that we actually activated the environment. And then we can install packages to the environment and use packages that have already been installed. And packages that we install inside of our virtual environment are only available when we are inside that environment, so they don't affect anything else. And that's going to help us a lot by avoiding any complications with other apps we're working on. And also we need to do that to later on deploy our app on a server. If you're using not Mac but Windows instead, the command is slightly different and shown below. So basically we are also entering the name of the environment, but then we use a backslash scripts, backslash activate without the word source, and that's going to activate the virtual environment on Windows. And if you're using Windows PowerShell, you may need to capitalize the word activate. So if we are done developing on our environment, the way we can stop our virtual environment or deactivate it is the following. We simply type in deactivate, and once we confirm that, we can see that here the entry in the parentheses, the name of our environment, disappears. So that means we are outside of our environment. But let's switch back into our environment, and once we're in there, we can continue by installing Django. So with our virtual environment activated, we're going to use the pip package manager to install Django. And this command is then going to download the Django module and is going to install it in our virtual environment. Now, once we installed Django, it's important to note that we can only use Django inside of our virtual environment, so we always need to make sure that we activate it before we continue working on our project. So once Django is installed, we are then going to be in our virtual environment and start a new project. So inside of our activated virtual environment, we are going to enter this command, Django admin, then start project. To create a new project, we're calling it learning_log. And then we have a dot at the very end, and that's going to create a new project with a directory structure that will make it easy to later on deploy our app. So let's confirm that. So let's take a look at what was actually created when we started our new app. So here we can see we have two separate directories, learning log and LLN for the name of our environment, and then we have a manage file in Python. So let's take a closer look at our learning log application. And if we take a look at that, we can see we have an init file here in Python and a number of additional files, for example, to configure the URLs and also to configure the settings. So the settings Python file here controls how Django interacts with our system and manages our project. The URLs file tells Django which pages to build in response to browser requests. And then this file here, WSGI, which stands for Web Server Gateway Interface, helps Django serve the files it creates. So once we set up our application, in the next step we are going to create the database. So Django stores most of the information for a project in a database, so therefore we need to create one. And to do these kind of operations, whenever we create a database or perform any migrations, we need to reference the manage.py file, which is a short program that takes in commands and feeds them to the relevant part of Django to run them. So here we are starting out by typing in python manage.py migrate, which is going to migrate our database, which is relevant whenever we make any changes to our database. So in our case here, we haven't made any changes yet, but we just created our new project. And when we run migrate like this for the first time, then that tells Django to make sure the database matches the current state of the project. And specifically, we are using SQLite, which is being used by default, and Django creates a new database for us. So if we take a look at the output, we can see that Django is reporting that it will prepare the database to store information it needs to handle administrative and authentication tasks. And then we can take a look at what was actually generated by typing in ls. And now we can see that an additional file was created. So here we can see the database file, which is an SQLite 3 file that we use by default. Later on, of course, we can switch to a different database, for example, Postgres SQL or MySQL. So let's make sure that Django actually has set up our project properly. To do that, we are going to type in this command. Again, we are going to use manage.py to perform an operation. And here we are typing in run server, which is going to start our server and show the default page. So here we have a system check that is checking if there are any issues we encounter. We can see the Django version, so version 4 in this case, that's being used. And then we are starting the development server at this specific IP address. And we can just control click on that and then say we want to open that URL. And that's going to open a browser window, and we can see our Django project. So here we see the default page. We can see the install worked successfully. And we can now access our application on this IP address, specifically on port 8000, which was automatically configured. And as we start creating additional pages, of course, this page will be updated, and later on we will be able to deploy that using Heroku. Now, if at this point you encounter an error message that the port we are using, in this case 8000, is already in use, we can also specify a specific port to run Django on. So in that case, I'm just gonna head over here and press Ctrl C to actually stop execution of our program for now. And then we could say, instead of just typing in run server, we can specify the port. So for example, let's say if port 8000 is not available, we can change that to 8001 and just enter the command again. And in this case, we are basically going through the same steps. And now we can see that's available on port 8001. So we basically updated the port, but typically that's not required. If you just enter the standard command, port 8000 should typically be available. A Django project is organized as a group of individual apps that work together to make the project work as a whole. For now, we'll just create one app to do most of our project's work, but then later on, we're going to add another app to, for example, manage user accounts. So for now, let's just leave this terminal window open where we're running our development server from. And instead, we're going to open a new terminal. And in here, we should navigate again to our project in which we have our manage.py file, because we are going to execute some commands for that. And of course, we initially need to activate our virtual environment again. So let's do that by entering the command. And of course, on Windows, you would need to enter a slightly adjusted command. We can see we are inside of our virtual environment. And now we can create a new app, which we are going to call Learning Logs. So here we are entering the command python manage.py start app learning logs. And now if you take a look at our project folder, we can see we have an additional folder here called learning logs. And inside of that, we are going to build our application. So let's take a look at the contents of this folder. And we can see we have a number of different files that are included in that. The most important ones are models.py, admin.py, and views.py. We're going to look at admin.py first, and then add the Views PI file a little bit later. Let's think about the data of our app for a moment. So each user will need to create a number of topics in their learning log. Each entry they make will be tied into a topic, and these entries will then be displayed as text. We'll also need to store the timestamp of each entry so we can show users when they made each entry. To make this modification, we can actually take a look at our app here, and we know that inside of learning logs we have a Python file called models, and we need to adjust that to change the data model of our application. So let's open that file, and we can see here we are importing models from django.db, and code-wise a model is just a class. So therefore what we can do is the following: we can create a new class called topic, which is going to inherit from models. With each topic that we create, we are going to have some text, and we have the date when it's added. The text attribute is a char field, so a piece of data that's made up of characters or text. And we also need to specify the maximum length that we can enter, so here we restrict that to 200 characters. Then we also need to specify the date added attribute. For that we are using date time field, which creates a time object, and we want to automatically set the time. Therefore we set the value for auto now add to true, which means that the current time will be used at the timestamp. So whenever we create a new topic, then the current timestamp is going to be used. We also tell Django which attributes to use by default when it displays information about a topic. To do that, we are using the string method here to display a simple representation of a model. So here we've written a string method that returns a string stored in the text attribute. In order to use our models, we have to tell Django to include our app in the overall project. And for that, if we take a look at our structure again, we have inside of our learning log directory the settings file, and we need to update that. So if we open that up, we can head over to that settings file, and here we have a list of the installed apps. These are the default apps that are automatically included, and we need to make sure that we add our own app in here. So to structure our code a little clearer, let's actually update that and say we differentiate between our own apps and then of course the default Django apps. And in here we are going to add our own app, so learning logs, separated with a comma. And it's important to place our own apps before the default apps, in case we need to override any of the behavior that the Django default apps provide with our own apps. Now once we made this update here in the settings file, and of course modifying our models file, we need to create migrations to save the changes made to our database. So for that, let's head back to our terminal. And here we are entering the command make migrations for our learning logs file. And that's going to tell Django to figure out how to modify the database so it can store the data associated with any new models we've defined. So let's confirm that. And the output here shows us that Django has created a new migration file, which is called 001initial. And now we need to apply those changes to the database. So for that, we are simply typing out python manage.py migrate. And that's going to apply those migrations. And we can see that this has been successfully applied. So whenever we want to modify the data that learning logs manages, we follow these three steps. We modify models.py, we call make migrations on learning logs, and then we tell Django to migrate the project. And Django makes it easy to work with our models through the admin side. Only the site's administrators can use the admin side, and we'll set up an admin side and use it to add some topics through the topic model. In Django, we can create a super user, which is a user who has all privileges available on the site. So in Django you can have different users with different access levels, and we need to create a super user in order to access the admin area of Django and to make modifications. So for that, let's head over to our terminal here, and in the terminal we're going to enter the command python manage py create super user, and now we can provide a username. So we can say, for example, we are going to call that llAdmin for learningbond.admin. Then we can provide an email address or just leave that blank. We need to enter a password and then repeat that password again. And that's going to create a new super user. And it's important to note, while the super user can access a lot of data, it's possible to hide some sensitive information from its site's super user or administrator. So for example, Django doesn't store passwords that are being entered by users, but instead it's creating a hash, and only that is stored. Even though a super user can access a lot of information, there are certain parts of sensitive information that can be stored in an encrypted way and are not shared generally. So Django includes some models in the admin side automatically, such as user and group, but the models we create need to be added manually. So to actually show them in the admin side, we need to modify our admin file. So if we think back inside of our Learning Logs app, we have a file called admin.py, and this is the one we are going to modify. So what we're going to do is we are going to first import the model that we want to register topic. And to do that, we're gonna import then from our models file, and that is located inside of the same folder as admin. So we can see here the admin file and also the models file, and therefore we can reference the current directory by just entering a dot followed by models. Once we have imported that, we can then register to the site by typing in admin site register and passing the topic to it, and then we can set the topic directly from the admin site. So to do that, let's head over to our application, and here in the URL we're going to add /admin, and if the site does not work, you may have to restart your server. So in here we are going to add the name of our user as well as the password we provided, and then we're signing in. And this admin page allows us to register new groups and users by default, but also to modify topics, which we just added to this page using this code over here. So let's now add some topics in here. We are just going to click on the plus button next to topics, and here we can provide the name of a topic. We didn't create any topic yet, so the page is empty, but we are going to create a new topic, and let's call it chess, which is now displayed here. And let's create another topic, and let's call it rock climbing. For a user to record what they've been learning about chess and rock climbing, we need to define a model for the kinds of entries users can make in their learning logs. And each entry needs to be associated with a particular topic. This relationship is called a many-to-one relationship, because many entries can be associated with one topic. So let's update our models file to actually implement that. And if we head over to our models.py file, we can add a second class after topic called entry. And here we are going to specify three different attributes: topic, text, and date edit. The first attribute, topic, is a foreign key instance. A foreign key is a database term. It's a reference to another record in the database. And that is a code that connects each entry to a specific topic. We're going to use these connections shortly to retrieve all entries associated with a certain topic. The onDelete option here specifies what happens when we delete a topic. And here we set it to models.cascade. That means when we delete a topic, all the entries associated with it should be deleted. This is also known as a cascading delete. The next attribute is called text, which is an instance of text field. This kind of field doesn't need a size limit because we don't want to limit the size of individual entries. Therefore, we don't pass an argument to it. And finally, we have date edit, which is kind of the same as we did before with the topics entry. So here we say again, this is of type date time field. And again, we're using the option here to automatically set the date time when a new entry is created. Inside of our entry class, we nest another class called meta. And the meta class holds extra information for managing a model. So here what we do is we specify what should happen if we have more than one entry, because by default, Django would pluralize entry as entries, spelled just with a YS at the end. But we want to tell it that actually entries should be written like that if we have more than one entry. So we do that in our attribute verbose name plural here, and then we specify a string method that tells Django which information to show when it refers to individual entries. So here we want to actually truncate what we display, meaning we are only going to display the first 50 characters of the entries that we provide. Now, because we've added a new model, we need to migrate the database again. And again, we're going to follow this three-step process. So we updated models.py in the first step. Then we're going to head over to our terminal. And here we need to create our migration. And once we create our migration, we can see we got a new entry here called 002entry.py. So all the different migrations are always updated here in terms of the number assigned to it. And the change always refers to what has actually changed. So in here we added the entry class, which is the name of the new migration. In the third step, of course, we need to perform our migration. So here we are just saying manage.py migrate, and it's going to perform the new migration. We can see that has worked successfully. So now in the next step, since we just updated the database, performed the migration, we can now register entries with the admin side, so we can also show it here on this page. To do that, we head over to admin.py, and here we are not just going to import the topic class, but also the entry class. And then of course, we also need to register that class with our admin side. So here we also say that we want to register not just topic, but also entry. Let's head back to our application and let's head back to the admin side. And now we should see an additional entry. So here we see not just topics, but also entries displayed. So now let's click on entries and let's select add entry as an option. And since we specified a foreign key here, each entry is actually associated with a topic. So we can select that here. And first of all, we are going to select chess. And now we can specify the entry, the text that we can enter in here. So let's enter some text in here. So once we entered our entry here, we can simply click on save to create this new entry. So let's create a second entry for chess and also an entry for rock climbing. And then we need to add another entry for rock climbing. And let's save that entry. And these three entries will give us something to work with as we continue to develop LearningLog. Now with some data entered, we can examine the data programmatically through an interactive terminal session. And this interactive environment is called Django Shell and is a great environment for testing and troubleshooting our project. So let's head over to our terminal, and to start a Python shell session, all we need to do is to type in Python manage py and then shell, and that's going to open the Django shell. So when we start our Python shell, this is actually going to open a Python interpreter that we can use to explore the data stored in our project's database. So we can start out by importing our topic class from our LearningLog's models module. And then we can take a look at all the various topics that we created. So in this case here, we have the topic chess and rock climbing. And the list here that's being returned is called a query set. We can loop over query sets just as we would loop over a list. So here's an example of that. So first of all, we are going to get back all of our topics and store them back in a topics attribute. Then we're going to loop over every single entry in our topics query set. And then we're going to print out the topic ID and the name of the topic. So here we can see we have chess, which has an ID 1, and rock climbing with ID 2. So if we know the ID of a particular object, we can use a specific method, topic objects get, to retrieve that object and examine any attribute the object has. So here we are using that call to get the object with ID number 1 and storing it back in the variable t. And then we can call text on t to display the text attribute associated with our object that we got back. So here we can see the text is chess. But we can also get the other attributes back. So here, for example, the date added. So if we take a look at that, we get back the timestamp when that was actually created. We can also look at the entries related to a certain topic. So earlier we defined the topic attribute for the entry model. This was a foreign key, a connection between each entry and a topic. So Django can use this connection to get every entry related to a certain topic. So to do that, we type in t.entryset.all. So to get the data through a foreign key relationship, we use the lowercase name of the related model followed by an underscore and the word set. And we are going to use this kind of syntax when we begin to code the pages users can request. Making web pages with Django consists of three stages. We need to define the URLs, write views, and then write templates. We can do these in any orders, but in this project we'll start by defining the URL patterns. So the URL pattern describes the way the URL is laid out. It also tells Django what to look for when matching a browser request with a site URL to know which page to return. And each URL then maps to a particular view. The view function retrieves and processes the data needed for that page. So what we're going to do is we'll define the URL for the homepage, write its view function, and create a simple template to display. So let's start out by mapping the URLs that we need. And first of all, we're going to start with the homepage URL. That's the base URL that will be displayed if we go to the root page. So at the moment, our homepage returns the default Django site, but we're going to update that. And to do that, we head over and we take a look at the urls.py file, which we can see inside of our learning log directory Here we are going to find the urls.py file. So let's open that up, let's head over here. So the first two lines in here import a module and a function to manage URLs for the admin side. And then we define a variable URL patterns, which define the different paths that are available. So for instance, if we go to the admin path, then we are returning whatever is specified here in admin side URLs. And we need to update that to display additional URLs. So let's start out by actually importing an additional module. In addition to importing paths, we also want to import include. And then we are also going to add another path here that uses the include function to display learninglogs.urls, which is going to be loaded here. So basically what we're doing is we create an additional urls.py file inside of learninglogs. The current one is inside of learninglog. So this is inside of our application that we created. And then we can create a new file called urls.py inside of learninglogs. So we got that over here. What we do is we initially import path, and we also need to import the views module. We then specify the app name here, learninglogs, and we define the URL patterns. And this is a list of individual pages that can be requested from the learninglogs app. The actual URL pattern is a call to the path function, which takes three arguments, as we can see here. The first argument is a string that helps Django route the current request properly. So here we are leaving this empty because we want to go to the root page. The second argument in path specifies which function to call in views.py. So here Django calls the index function from views.py. And then the third argument provides the name index for this URL pattern, so we can refer to it in other code sections. So whenever we want to provide a link to the homepage, we'll use this name instead of writing out a URL. So we can just reference this as index. Next, we need to write a view function. And a view function takes in information from a request, prepares the data needed to generate a page, and then sends the data back to the browser, often by using a template that defines what the page will look like. So when we created our map initially by typing in python manage.py startup, we already created a default views.py file. We can take a look at that by displaying what has been created inside of learninglogs, and we can see there's a file called views.py. So we can open that file and take a look at that, and we can see that initially we import the render method here from Django shortcuts, and then we can define our views in here. So here we are going to define a view function, which we call indexed, that takes in a request, and this is going to render this particular URL when we receive a request. So when a URL request matches the pattern we just defined, Django looks for a function called index in our views.py file. And the render function here passes two arguments, the original request object and a template it can use to build the page. So let's create that template that can be rendered, this one here. And a template generally defines what the page should look like. So let's first of all create a new folder. So if we go back to our terminal, we can switch into our learninglogs folder. And in here we are going to create a new folder called templates. Let's switch into templates. And inside we can create another folder called learninglogs. That might seem a little redundant, but it sets up the structure that Django can interpret very easily, even in the context of a large project, which contains a lot of individual apps. So here we can now create a new file, index.html. So once we created that file, we can open it up in our code editor. And now we can specify the file that we actually want to render. So in our case, it's going to be a simple HTML file for now. So that's a very simple file that we created. So we can see we are using the paragraph tag, which is an HTML tag, to first of all define the first paragraph, which is learning log, and then a second paragraph, which includes this kind of text. So now that we saved our file inside of learning logs, let's just double check that. So we have our templates folder here, we have the learning logs directory, and if we take a look at that, we can see inside of that we have the index.html. That means that from views.py, we are actually rendering learninglogs/index.html, which is inside the templates folder. So now we can head back to our application, and if you reload the page, we see this page here. So the two paragraphs are being displayed and rendered properly as we go to the root page of our application. Now let's take a closer look at what's actually happening. So when we type in our URL and send off a request, then Django will take the requested URL, and that URL will match the pattern that we saw before. So basically this one here. And Django will call the function views.index, which we defined here. This is going to execute the index function inside of our views file, and this in turn then renders our learning logs index template, which of course we specified here, and then that's basically returned to our browser and displayed here. And at this point that might look like a very complicated process for creating one page and having the separation between URLs, views and templates, but that works quite well and it's quite scalable, especially as we have a larger application with multiple apps and with a lot of pages that should be displayed. And also it allows us to split the work according to the focus. So for example, a database specialist can focus on the models, a programmer can focus on the view code, and a web designer can focus on the templates. Now that we have established a routine for building a page, we can start to build out the learning log project itself. So we're going to build two pages that display data, a page that lists all topics and a page that shows all the entries for a particular topic. And for each page, we'll specify a URL pattern, write a view function and write a template. But before we do that, we'll create a base template that all templates in a project can inherit from. So when building a website, some elements will always need to be repeated on each page. And rather than duplicating the code over and over again, we can write a base template containing the repeated elements, then have each element inherit from the base. And this approach lets us focus on developing the unique aspects of each page and make it much easier to change the overall look and feel of the project in the future. So to get started with that, we'll create a template called base.html in the same directory as index.html. So let's take a look at that. We have here index.html inside of learning logs inside of our templates folder. So let's head over and let's create a new file. So the first part of this file creates a paragraph containing the name of the project, which acts as a homepage link. To generate a link, we use a template tag, which is indicated by braces and percentage signs. A template tag generates information to be displayed on a page. Our template %URL learning logs index generates a URL matching the URL pattern defined in learninglogsurl.py. And in a simple HTML page, we can create a link just by using the anchor tag here, a and then closing a, and then using href and assigning the URL to it. And having the template tag generate the URL for us makes it much easier to keep our links up to date. We only need to change the URL pattern in urls.py, and Django will automatically insert the updated URL the next time the page is requested. So every page in our project will inherit from base.html, so from now on every page will have a link back to the homepage. And then after we define that, we are adding a pair of block tags, and this block named content is a placeholder. So the child template will define the block of information that goes inside the content block. So basically, we are going to replace this section here with our different child pages that we define, but this part here on top, the link area here, will always be the same across all the various pages. So now we need to rewrite our index.html file that we wrote before to inherit from base.html. So to do that, we are going to add some entries at the very top. So here on top, we're stating that we want to basically extend our learning logs base.html file that we have here. So therefore, this part here will basically be inserted on top. And then for the block content here, for this particular page, we are going to insert this part here. So learning log and learning log, the text here, that is basically going to fit in here in our template. And therefore, on our page, on our index.html page, we're going to have the link on top served by base.html, and then the additional content in here. So we can already see the advantage here. So if we wanted to update index.html and a bunch of other pages, and we don't want to update the actual content, but for example, the heading here, all we need to do is to head over to base.html and make a change in here. And then by using this extends syntax here, all the other pages that are extending this template are going to be updated automatically. And in a large project, it's common to have one parent template called base.html for the entire site, and then parent templates for each major section on the site. And all the section templates inherit from base.html, and each page in the site inherits from a section template. And this way we can easily modify the look and feel of a site as a whole and any section in this site or any individual page. Now let's take a look at what our updated website actually looks like. If we reload the page here, we can see we now have the link here on top that was added. So this way we can always get back to the page. So now that we have an efficient approach to building pages, we can focus on our next two pages, the general topics page and the page to display entries for a single topic. And first we need to define the URL for the topics page. And it's common to choose a URL fragment that reflects the kind of information presented on the page. So we'll use the word topics. So the URL is going to be localhost and then our port slash topics, and that's going to return that page. So for that, we are going to update our URLs file. So let's switch over to that. And here just below our homepage, we are going to add a second entry for our topics page. So here we have simply added topics into the string argument and used it for the homepage URL. When Django examines a requested URL, this pattern will match any URL that has a base URL followed by topic. And we can decide to include or omit this slash here at the end of topics. That's really up to us. So since inside of this pass here we're referencing views.topics, we need to add a topics function inside of our views.py file. So let's head over there and let's add that. And before we do that, we still need to import the topics class. So let's say we are going to import from modules our topics class. And then we can define our topics function. So our topics function needs one parameter, the request object Django receives from the server. We then query our database by requesting the objects from topic. We then query the database by asking for the topic objects sorted by the date edit attribute. And we store the results back in topics. We then define the context which we are going to send to our template. And a context is a dictionary in which the keys are names we'll use in the template to access the data, and the values are the data we need to send to the template. So in this case, there's one key value pair which contains a set of topics we'll display on the page. And then finally, we are going to pass our context to our render method along with the request. And since the template for the topics page receives the context dictionary, the template can use the data that our topics function provides. So now we're going to create a separate file topics.html, basically very similar to the index.html file we created before. So again, we're using the extend syntax here to basically extend based off our base template, base.html, and then we insert the information for the block content. So here we have first of all a paragraph as a topics, and then we have an unordered list of entries, and then we're creating a for loop. So we're looping over all the topics in topic, and whenever we have a logic like that, we need to have this particular syntax where we have these curly braces and then the percentage sign, and we close and we open and we close that. And here at the end, of course, we need to end our loop. So we say open parentheses, percentage sign, end for, and then we close that. And whenever we want to render a variable, then we need to use these two opening and closing parentheses. And inside of that, we are passing the variable that should be rendered in our template. So here we want to display all the topics, so therefore we are using this syntax here. And if there are no entries in our topics list, then this empty action is going to be triggered. So then instead of displaying the topics, we are going to display no topics have been added yet. And the syntax here is part of the templating engine being used, which is called Jinja. Now, one thing we need to do is to modify the base template to include a link to the topics page. So if we head over to base.html, all we're going to do is to add a second link in here. And so we add a dash after the link to the homepage, and then we add a link to the topics page using again our Jinja syntax here. And this tells Django to generate a link matching the URL pattern with the name topics in learninglogsurls.py. Now let's take a look at our website again. And when we refresh that, we can see we have the entry learning logs, then the dash we added, and then the topics page. So now when we click on topics, we are forwarded, and here we can see the different topics. And this is achieved through the for loop we wrote before. So if there are more topics, then of course our list will be extended. So next we need to create a page that can focus on a single topic, showing the topic name and all the entries for the topic. And again, we are going to define a new URL pattern, write a view, and create a template. However, the URL pattern for this topic page is a little different than to the prior URL patterns, because it will use a topic's ID attribute to indicate which topic was requested. So for example, we created the chess topic before, and that was the first topic we created, so that should have the ID 1, and we need to match those specific IDs to the specific URL. So to accomplish that, let's head over to our urls.py file inside of our learning logs application, and here we can add another path to it. In this case, we want to say that we can access individual pages for a single topic by going to topics slash, and then we have a specific entry here. So we are going to display an integer, for example, 1, 2, 3, that is going to be matched to the topic ID that we have in here. And so when we specify the topic ID, that will be shown here in the path. And of course, as before, we are referencing that in views.topic. And this is going to be accessible through the name topic within our Django application. So as before, we need to head over to views and create a new function called topic. So this is the first view function that we wrote that requires in a parameter aside from request. So aside from passing request to it, we also need the topic ID. And the topic ID, of course, is provided here in the path function we wrote before. So here we have this kind of syntax, topic slash, and then the specific topic ID, which is passed over, and then of course stored inside of topic. We then use get to retrieve the topic, just as we did in the Django shell before. Next we get the entries associated with that topic, and we are ordering them by the date added. Specifically, we're adding the minus sign in front of date edit, which is going to give us back the reverse order. So we're going to see the latest entry first. And then we are storing the topic and the entries in the context dictionary. And finally, we are going to call the render method here, and we send the context over here to the template topic HTML. And whenever we write queries like this up here, typically makes sense to first try them out in the Django shell, just to make sure that they really retrieve the data we expect. And then of course, in the next step, we can add them to the view function as we do right here. So let's next create the view template. So for this, we are going to create a new HTML file, and this is called topic.html. So again, we're going to extend learninglogspace.html to have the same header in there. And then inside of our blog content, we are first of all going to render the specific topic, so for example, chess, and then we list the entries associated with that topic. So for that, we are going to loop over all the entries by using this for loop here inside of that Jinja syntax. And in there, we are going to create a list item. And specifically, we are going to display the date when the entry was added and also the text of the entry. And if we take a look here at both those entries, we can see there's a vertical line displayed, a pipe character, and that represents a template filter. So a function that modifies the value in a template variable. So the first filter here, date, displays timestamps in the format of, for example, January 1st, 2018, and then the time. And the next line displays the full value of text rather than just the first 50 characters. And the filter line breaks ensure that long text entries include line breaks in a format understood by the browser rather than showing a very long block of uninterrupted text. And again, we are using the empty tag to deal with the case if there's no entry associated with the topic. And before we look at the topics page in the browser, we need to modify our topics template that we created before. So if we head over here, because we want to link to the different topics available. So we use the URL template tag to generate the proper link based on the URL pattern in learning logs with the name topic. And this URL pattern requires a topic ID argument, so we add the attribute topic.id to the URL template tag. Now each topic in the list of topics is a link to a topic page, and we can from therefore basically click on the link to take a look at the specific topic. So let's save that change and let's head back over to our website. And let's take a look at our topics list. And let's click on chess, for example. And now we can see the various entries that belong to our chess topic. We see the timestamp being rendered here. And we also see the text that is associated with each of those entries. And that's the first part of the learning log application. We, of course, going to extend it and build on top of it. we learned how to build simple web applications using the Django framework. We installed Django, set up a new project, and also learned about databases and migrations in Django. We also learned how to set up URL structures in Django, how to create view functions, and set up templates. If you have any questions about that, feel free to add them down in the comment section below. In the next video, we are going to learn about user registration in Django. See you guys in the next video.